Going to record this?
Good morning. Jay Bhava, welcome to our celebration of Kitty Davy. We're happy everyone's here today. It's a small group, but it's a mighty group. We're all open-hearted and ready to hear more about Kitty's life. And Karen Talbot is going to share a bio. I have a little film. Jim Meyer is here, going to sing a song and talk some. So we'll get started with Karen. Jay Bhava, good morning.
Hey, Baba, everyone. First of all, I'm going to ask everyone that's listening, if there are any corrections in what I'm saying, please let me know, okay? So I'm just going to also start by saying how much I miss Kitty and how many times, how wonderful she was, and how many times in my life I keep thinking, if only I could ask Kitty. Kitty was born on August 28, 1891 in London, England. Her parents were John and Helena Davy. There were 9 siblings in her family. Perhaps the best known in the Baba world was her brother Herbert Davy. She worked for 15 years as a music teacher. She met Meherabad on September 11, 1931. Kitty lived in India from 1937 to 1952. She lived in Myrtle Beach from 1952 through 1991. She died December 3rd, 1991, and is buried to the far left of Mera's Tomb Shrine at Meherabad Hill by Meherabad's Samadhi. Her brother Herbert was a medical student. He was interested in spirituality and he wanted a quiet retreat during a school break. So he went to East Chalicombe to be with Meredith Starr. Margaret came along with him. Herbert urged Kitty to visit. On September 11th, 1931, Meherabad arrived in Marseille. Kitty was part of a very small group to greet Baba for the first time at London's Victoria Station. She was 40 years old. During this visit, Meherabad stayed at their family home at 32 Russell Road, Kensington, London, England. Shortly after Kitty Davy first met Meherabad in 1931, he asked her what she wanted. Without thinking, she replied, an increased capacity to love and increased opportunities for service, and yes, spontaneous goodness. Meherabad replied, you will have all in a few days. On Meherabad's return in 1932, he stayed mostly at Kitty's family home. The Paramount newsreel with Charles Purdom was filmed on April 10th, 1932, in their backyard. In 1933, Baba invited 10 individuals from England and America to go to India for 6 months, but they only stayed 3 weeks before being sent back home. Kitty was one of those that went. On April 6th, 1933, they arrived in Bombay. They met Mera, Mani, Naja, Korshid, and Valu. Mani was 14 years old at that time. In 1937, Kitty Elizabeth, Norina, Rana, and Mani went back to India with Baba. On November 20th, 1937, they arrived in Bombay. Kitty writes, that same evening began my most treasured period, lasting over 15 years with Meherabad and his Eastern group of Western disciples. First in the ashram on Meherabad Hill, and later in the places which Baba took us to in India. In 1937, Kitty lived with the others at the Nasik ashram. In December of 1938, Baba and up to 30 women disciples began traveling all over India in a special blue bus built for 16 passengers. The men Mandali traveled by train. During the new life, Kitty and Rana were given a choice to return to their respective countries or remain in India. And this was 1949. They both chose to remain in India. Baba sent them to live with Meherji's family and to earn a living. They had a difficult time finding work, but Meherji's wife suggested they contact the principal of St. Mary's High School, where their daughter attended school. The principal, Miss Groom, hired Kitty. Kitty decided to teach English rather than piano. She was so conscientious that she worked overtime so her students could acquire a thorough knowledge of English. Rana was hired part-time to teach drawing and painting. During this time, and unexpectedly, Baba called them to a visit if and only if they could get their jobs back. Miss Groom agreed to their request without any questions. This occurred on two more occasions. At the end of their stay, they both asked Miss Groom why she never questioned their request for leave. She said she felt that Kitty and Rana changed the school atmosphere. On their last day, the students came with garlands and flowers for Kitty and Rana. Meher Baba had invited them to join him in Andhra State. On June 1951, Meher Baba called back the old life disciples. In April 1952, Meher Baba left India to visit the U.S. Kitty was one of the women who traveled with them for the first visit to the Meher Center. Kitty called the Meher Center a miracle of his love. Kitty was in Sarosha's car with Rano, Dr. Gohair, and Delia during the Prague, Oklahoma accident in 1952, May 24th. After Meher Baba's accident, he asked Kitty if she would stay in America to help Norina, to help Elizabeth convalesce, and to help Elizabeth with the work at the center. His last direct order to Kitty was to keep his center in 100% order, ready for his return, and to be Elizabeth's right hand in any way helpful. She characteristically replied, "Why, yes, of course, Baba." When following the avatar, she wrote in Love Alone Prevails, "Expect the unexpected." In 1955, Kitty writes, "One of my dreams for the center was a library of materials by and about Meher Baba. She gradually began collecting books, pamphlets, and other materials for a future library." Kitty and Elizabeth had been living at Yopan Dunes. Then Elizabeth built Dilruba, which was called the Gateway to Baba's House. There, Elizabeth set a book room aside for Kitty. Eventually, the Sarosha Library came to be. Throughout the years, Kitty cared for Ruth White, who lived to be 100. On September 1st, 1959, Kitty wrote in a letter to Mani, "Ruth White is wonderful for her vitality. I think she must have a superb nervous system. I shudder to think what mine would be if I lived to be 90. In 1962, at the East-West Gathering, Kitty writes, "I remember when it was my turn to come to Baba's chair. I asked Baba if I would be returning to India to stay with him. Erich translated Baba's gestures and said I was to remain in Myrtle Beach and help Elizabeth. I knew then, and I think that others too felt, that we were not going to see Baba again. In fact, Baba did say to one that we would not see him again." This, Kitty said, was the saddest day of her life. Kitty gave tirelessly to each one who visited the Meher Center, offering practical and spiritual kindness to each one who visited her office. She maintained her bookstore at the same time. She lived and worked on the Meher Spiritual Center until her death at the age of 100 in 1991. Her ashes are interred near Meher Baba's Samadhi in Meherabad, India. Kitty was the author of two books, Love Alone Prevails, A Story of Life with Meher Baba, published in 1981, which recounts the 50 years of her life spent as one of his closest disciples. And she also wrote One Fine Thread, talks about Meher Baba. Here are a few words said of Kitty. In Nasik, Baba said to Kitty, "You love me for love itself." And to others, "Tell Kitty she is wonderful in all ways, good and bad." In a letter sent from Sitara on December 27, 1954, Mani wrote of Kitty, "What we miss, dear Kitty, is your ready sympathy, encouragement, and enthusiasm. At any and all times, Kitty was the epitome of enthusiasm." Kitty said enthusiasm was being alive with God. In the mid-1980s, one day in Mandalay Hall, Kitty asked Erich about consciousness. Right away, instead of answering the question, Erich marveled aloud to all present. "Look at this. After so many years in his presence and his service, look how she is, not placing herself above anyone, keeping her focus on him, with no self-importance. She could do that, but she doesn't. Instead, she is only for him." When Baba asked, "Who do you take me to be? Do you wish to hold on to me till the very end?" he instructed each of the Mandalay to give him a written and signed reply. Kitty's response was, "Your love brought me to you. Your love has kept me with you, and your love will bind me to you till the end." Our generation has been the beneficiary of Kitty's loving kindness and loving concern for each and every one. I would like to end by mentioning a wonderful YouTube, well worth watching, a tribute to Kitty Davy given by Jim Meyer. Kitty had this incredible quality of immediately endearing herself to anyone who met her. Charles Haynes said she was there for everyone, and I think we can all agree on that. Jay Meherabad.
Hey, Baba. Karen, thank you. That was beautiful. Always.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah, I love your bios. You're so heartfelt in delivery.
Love Kitty.
Oh, God, I know. Well, I just have a short video, just some photos and a little music by Tuck Andrus in the background that just kind of puts us in the space of Kitty with Baba in photograph. Hey, Baba. Oh, here we go. Thank you. Jay Baba. So much went through my mind as I was looking at those photos, but I'm going to kind of open it up to others. I'll just say this, I don't really remember the first time I met Kitty, but I know that when I used to go to the center, I guess it was 1970, you had to go to see Kitty or Elizabeth on your stay at the center. When you got there, you would have to go in to see them. And so that's probably the first time I met Kitty. I didn't meet Elizabeth, but I met Kitty. And I don't know exactly how it transpired, but I do know that what she did for me was she welcomed me. She made me feel loved. She had such a bubbly way that I just felt my spirits rising just being with her. And she focused it all at Meherabad, so that my stay there started on that note of complete focus on Baba. So what can I say, but thank you, Baba. All right, well, if anybody wants to raise a hand, that'd be great. And Jimmy Boy's here with a song and a story. So I'm gonna ask you if you'd like to start off with anything.
Jay Baba, everybody. It was wonderful to see pictures of Kitty. I think I first met Kitty in 1967 on my first visit to the center. We're talking many years ago, so my memory's not particularly strong about the early days, but in 1969, I started working on the center, and working on the center as a caretaker meant that every morning I had the wonderful privilege of being instructed first by Kitty, then by Elizabeth, and then follow up again by Kitty. And I've told these stories before, but I was trying to think of a story that I hadn't told, and I'm not sure if I've told this story, but I'm going to do it anyway, whether I told it. So most of us are so old it doesn't matter, because it's like hearing it all fresh. Well, I was very serious about Meherabad when I was a young man. Serious in a very self-conscious way. I'm serious about Meherabad to this day, but not in the same self-conscious, self-righteous way as I was when I started working on a center. And I was very frustrated following Meherabad because I used to write out manifestos to Meherabad, you know, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. I literally put it in writing. And then the next day, of course, I would break the manifesto, you know. So I was very frustrated. And in fact, I reached such a point of exasperation that the only person I could talk to about these matters was Kitty. So, of course, she knew something was up. She said, "Jim, what's the matter?" And I said, "Well, Kitty, I don't think I can go any further spiritually in this lifetime. I try to do these things and I just fail every time, and I just don't think I'm going to progress any further." And I was dead serious, and I was, full of myself. And Kitty looks at me and she goes, "Oh, you silly boy." So when she said, "You silly boy," immediately I lost my edge. I immediately realized, yeah, I'm a silly boy. That's exactly what I am. And she's just nailed me, and I should stop being a silly boy. So that was a wonderful. And in conjunction with that, one time while I was in her office and we were talking about what we needed to do for the day, clean this cabin, or I used to package books for her to mail out. All of a sudden, I've told this story, the atmosphere got very serious, very dense in her office. It was usually very light with me. It got very dense, and she looked at me and she said, are you happy all the time? I said, no, Kitty, I'm not happy all the time. She said, well, do you think about Baba all the time? I said, no, Kitty, I don't. She said, well, that's the problem.
Oh.
And I realized at that moment, if anybody else had said that to me, I would have been defensive. But because Kitty Davy said it to me, and she had the authority to say, do you remember Baba all the time? Well, you're not happy because you don't remember Baba all the time. She was telling me not only what I needed to do, but she was also putting a stamp on her who she was. She was capable of thinking about Baba all the time and being happy all the time in his presence. All right. Enough of this. At Meherazad and at Meherabad and at the Meher Spiritual Center and at the Pilgrim Center and in various other places of importance to the Meher Baba, there are three couplets from Hafez. Meher Baba put a great deal of emphasis and importance on these couplets, and I'm going to read them because it was from these couplets that I wrote this song to Kitty Davy and Erich. I never told Kitty I wrote a song to her, and I certainly didn't tell Erich I wrote a song to her, to him, because they don't want to hear, they didn't want to hear that. They just wanted just do, you know, everything was for Baba. But this is the three couplets from Hafez. Hafez says, befitting the fortunate slave, carry out every command of the master without any question of why and what. About what you hear from the master, never say it is wrong, because, my dear, the fault lies in your own incapacity to understand him. I am the slave of the master who has released me from ignorance. Whatever my master does is of the highest benefit to all concerned. So this was, and Kitty liked this song, even though I didn't but told her I wrote it with her and Erich in mind. This is called The Fortunate Slave. Here is the tale of the fortunate slave. Obeys her master from cradle to grave. So few could be so courageous and brave to live the life, befitting the fortunate slave. Befitting the fortunate, never questions the what or why. All she knows is to do or die. There's no task that she would not try to live the life. Befitting the fortunate slave, befitting the fortunate. I am the slave of my master who has freed my soul, released me from the bondage of my mind's control. All he ever does, he does from love. So who am I to question what God dreams of? I only know his pleasure is my goal. Is every woman wish my begging bowl, and every humble effort that I gave was reward enough just to be his slave. Here is the tale of the fortunate slave, another bubble in the ocean's wave, whose perfect bondage may the master raise her to the heights. Befitting the fortunate slave, befitting the fortunate. Her life's the message, her life's the goal. His very being loves burning coal. There's no desire but to play the role, to live the life, the fitting, the fortunate slave, the fitting, the fortunate. I am the slave of my master who has freed my soul, released me from the bondage of my mind's control. All he ever does, he does from love. So who am I to question what God dreams of? I only know his pleasure is my goal, is every woman wish my begging bowl, and every humble effort that I gave was reward enough just to be his slave.
Oh, Jay Bhava. Beautiful song, Jim. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Yeah, you created that atmosphere of what it was like back in those days, coming to the center with your stories as well.
Well, the song is rings true to her life. I mean, I've only met a few people on this planet, and maybe only one or two in the West, who were as advanced as Kitty Davy. And even then, I think she was just, she was miles above me. Miles, miles above me.
Yeah, you know, it's true. I kind of felt that when I came and met her. She was the first person that I met that had met Meherabad. So just coming into her presence, but she was so down to earth, and she made me feel so, she was just so authentic. She made me comfortable. I mean, it was something that I had never seen in a human before.
You started at the top. You could only go downhill from there.
We're not going to talk about that. Yeah, I had a friend, I remember, again, we would sometimes would pay when we left at Dilruba, would go and pay for our week stay. So leaving the center, would have to go there and pay. So I went one evening, it was dark, and I was going home to a relationship that was dissolving, and I was glad, but it was hard to extricate. And I just was talking to the fella who was driving me back to Pittsburgh, a friend, about this situation. And he said, as we pulled up into the driveway of Dilruba, talk to Kitty about this. And I thought, oh my God, are you kidding? I could never talk to her about a relationship thing like this. I mean, this is trivial stuff. I could never do that. And he said, no, no, no. He said, Kitty Davy is everybody's grandmother. And I thought, oh, okay, well, and I scurried in to pay. And the minute I came into her presence and looked at her, I started to chuckle. And she said, what is it? And I said, oh, it's just that Kevin said you're everybody's grandmother. And she, I don't know how she responded, but whatever it was so open that I was able to bring forward my issue and lay it out there. And of course, she asked about my part in it. Her first thing, you know, was my questioning, my integrity, my honesty, you know, the way I was in this so-called problem. And of course, it just clarified everything, and I still suffered a lot throughout that, but it was having something to stand on. Kitty gave me that ground to stand on and deal with that problem as a young individual. So I'm so grateful, and I just pray for the Baba people that are young now that they have that same kind of ground like Kitty provided in some of the people. But anyway, I digress. Oh, hi, Heidi. Jay Baba. Well, I'm wondering if anybody else. Heidi, do you have anything you want to share?
Yeah, I was cleaning, and I got this little vibe from Kitty that this was on today. I had forgotten. and my hair looks like Dr. Zorba. And I could hear Jim, a video that Jim did, the story when you were going to visit Kitty. I don't know all the details, but I remember you said she got all gussied up for you. So I said, well, I'll just get gussied up and I'll put my orange lipstick on. So Kitty, I had a special time with Kitty when I was really young. It was, I guess, maybe 1970 or so. And it was the second time I went to the center. The first time I went to the center, I took a Greyhound bus for 18 hours. And I got permission to go, and I was all excited. And a woman was sitting on the bus. She had a disability crutch, and she was running away from her husband. And I was like, I don't know, 18. And I turned around to her at one point, and she told me, asked me where I was going. I told her, and she told me she was running away from her husband to find a lost high school love. And I said, are you sure you're doing the right thing? She got so upset. When we took the break to get off the bus, a 15-minute break, I said, can I get you anything? You know, any refreshments? She says, she gives me $50. And she says, go get me a ticket to Myrtle Beach. I'm coming with you. And I panicked and I said, I can't do that. I got special permission. And so I got on the phone. I'm calling Fred Winterfeld. Fred Winterfeld answers the phone and I'm yakking away. And he says, all right, you come, I bring you to Kitty. Hangs up the phone. I'm like, oh shit. So anyway, I get back on the bus, she comes. So that's how I first met Kitty, and it was traumatic because she had to meet with both me and this woman, Maggie. She put us in the lake cabin. She stayed longer than I did. So the second time, I was a little scared. I was by myself. I go see Kitty, and she asks me, she says, oh, and what are you doing? What are you doing with your life? And I was in school for social work. And I said that to her. She got so excited, and she started to talk about Baba and service. And I'm thinking, wow, this is really a special conversation. And I listened, and the whole room just, you know, lit up. She was the epitome of service, like right in front of me. And I said to myself, this is just a Baba gift that you could, I didn't know that much about Kitty. And it was so special. And she gave me, there was a Baba group that got started in Philadelphia. I was part of it with John Dennison, the real old days. We had a Baba bookstore. So I told her a little bit. So she gave me all these old Awakeners magazines, and I still have them. And she said, take this for the Baba group. Yes, you'll give them out. You'll take them back. You'll lend them out. Yeah, okay, Kitty, I'll lend them out. And so I was leaving, and I'm walking on cloud 9. And it must be about noon, and she reminded me to put ammonia on for the mosquitoes. And I hated that. I did it because she said so. And she turns around to me, and she says, okay, well, I'll see you at 6 o'clock for dinner. I said, huh? What is she talking about? And dinner, 6 o'clock. So I walk out, and I thought, did she just tell me to come back at 6 o'clock for dinner? No, she didn't. That's impossible. But she did. And so I walked back to her house later, and we had just a beautiful time. I don't even remember the conversation, but who she was, I got, and I'll never forget it. And she was really with it. You know, for me, I felt like she always knew not only what was going on, but she kind of knew what you needed. And she kind of led the way in conversation to bring it out so she could help you. She was just always a giver in service and to Baba. So I just wanted to share that because she turned a key for me. I had a very successful, hard career in social work. But I always thought of her when I was struggling. Always heard her voice. So, thank you.
Betty, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Jay.
Thank you, Heidi.
Ralph, did you want to say something about Kitty?
Kitty, when I hitchhiked to Myrtle Beach from Silver Spring, Maryland, and I'd called the center number, which was Belruba then, around 9 o'clock at night, or it was late. I think it was the day after Christmas, and Elizabeth picked up the phone. Apparently, she must have been dozing or something, because she seemed a little annoyed that I was calling at whatever hour it was. And I asked her what was the function of the Meher Spiritual Center. And that made her even more displeased and out of sorts to be asked a stupid question. What a function? Like, is it a piston or is it a drive shaft or is it the fan blade? You know, and she said, function. Well, and she kind of set me straight in that regard and got me a little more oriented very quickly and briefly. And I told her I was going to come, and she said, well, get yourself to the Greyhound bus station in town and call us, and I'll send someone out down to bring you here. And so she did. And though I was coming from my parents' place, you know, I'd been in Texas, mostly in Waco. And Lord have mercy, a fellow from Waco, Texas came and picked me up. It was Nick Coleus. And he was very quiet. I couldn't get anything out of him to speak of. You know, he would, except he was out from Waco. He did share that with me. And we went to the house. And went to the front door, and Kitty opened the door and showed us in. Well, Nick had been there, and he and a few others gathered around the fireplace, which was roaring. And Margaret was there sharing Baba stories. And Ruth White was sitting there with them also, very quiet. But I noticed her, but mostly noticed Margaret. And Kitty, I just barely saw her and heard her. She didn't really even introduce herself. She just showed us into the door. And then from there, they took me to, I think it was the fire cabin. And that was my first introduction to Kitty. Yeah, I'll leave it there. So, the next day I did go to Kitty's office, and she asked me about how I heard of Baba. And we shared that, we talked about that, and she gave me a literature and some, you know, pamphlets, and we talked about books. And I don't remember what all. And I had spent that night, and then the night I arrived, I spent the next day and a night, and the next morning I was on my way. And really, though I'd seen pamphlets about Baba, including the Universal Message, Who is Meher Baba, God in the Pill, I really didn't have, even with the Universal Message there, you know, in my crawl, I still didn't have any real notion of Meher Baba. The yogi, miss what? I had no idea. But I got that idea from the few words that I got from Margaret. I realized that Baba, from her talking about Baba, that Baba was very something very special. Yeah. The divine beloved, that never crossed, such a thing never crossed my mind. But it began to from that point, yeah. Jay Bob. So Kitty there, I saw her, and probably prior to leaving. And then over the years, I was fortunate to spend a fair amount of time with her. One of her favorite stories with me was one day in the summer, I walked up to her office and it was hot and she had her door open and the screen was there. She was at her desk and she saw me. She jumped up and she said, "Ralph, you're tall. There was a porch light." And last night after Artie, a few of us were talking, got talking about snakes. And Kitty, you know, had a fear of snakes, which Baba sort of put, she had, Baba once knew that she had a fear of snakes. And what was it? Baba planted a rubber snake on a windowsill there, wherever they were, at Meherabad, I presume, or one of the other at Toka or her. So, and Baba came and got Kitty and said, "Snake, kill this snake." And it was a rubber snake Baba had put on the windowsill. And Kitty saw it and she said, I don't know her words, I don't remember, but she was freaking out. She told this story a lot. You probably all heard it, perhaps. And she went over and started beating on that stick on the snake with the stick Bob had given her. And then she saw how it bounced and she was sort of stunned, you know? I mean, it caught her off guard. And she realized something and she halted and turned around and Baba was just laughing away. So there was a bird's nest built a nest between the wall of the house and the porch light. And Kitty said, "Ralph, you're tall. The birds have hatched and gone. Can you reach that and lift it out? And I want to just pitch it out in the woods." So I reached up there and I picked it up like a big bowl and holding it overhead, I brought it down between Kitty and I. There was a big old black snake in bird's nest. And I saw it and I don't remember what I did, but I was shocked. After that, I don't remember what happened with that snake, but Kitty said, "Oh." She didn't scream or anything like that. She had gotten over her fear of snakes. Baba had sort of taken that away. So I don't remember what happened to that snake. I think Malcolm was nearby there and had garden tools and may have come and killed the snake. That's one Kitty story.
Great stories. I had heard one about, I don't know if this is just somebody extrapolated, made it up, but in the early days, they said that Baba, when he was in Myrtle Beach at the center, had arranged for a garden hose. I don't know how if it was black or what he did, but he had arranged for people to kind of move it in a certain way so it looked like a snake when Kitty came out and scared her with this garden hose. And then when she looked, there was Baba just chuckling because he got her again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
may have been the time. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ruthie, good morning, and thank you for this lovely remembrance. I think that two stories have gotten kind of mixed together. The one that you told from Myrtle Beach, I think is quite accurate. And the one that Ralph was mentioning from Meherabad, as I recall, and recall Mani sharing this, that it was her that made a snake out of like dough and kind of hardened. And it was particular, they were, and they set it outside the kitchen window where they knew that Kitty would see it as a practical joke. And Kitty did go out and took whatever instrument she used, you know, like a usually these days it's a shovel, but at any rate, I'm not sure what it was in the 30s or 40s, and tried to kill it. And then the dough just splattered, you know, it was dried and so forth. So I think we've got two different incidents, one with Baba at Myrtle Beach and one from Mani at Meherabad.
I think you're right.
The hose, was that Myrtle Beach, Ruth?
I think that's the way it was told in the early
days. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, so you could picture it, you know, when you were at the center, you could kind of picture
it. I'm pretty sure Judy's story and mine are one and the same.
Yeah. Well, Ralph, thank you. If you have anything else that comes up, let me know, because we'd love to hear. It just brings
back. I call Sheila Krinsky. She's a well Kitty stories, and she's all tied up with work. They're on a deadline with the book or something. She begged out.
Well, I did. I had her, I think I invited her a year or two ago. And so it was wonderful. And I thought of it this morning when I saw a photo of her and Kitty.
Yeah.
It would have been nice to have Sheila as well. But I'm very happy that you are here and Jim is here. And, you know, some Heidi, some of the people that had those opportunities in the early days.
Yeah.
Kitty, that's amazing. You know, I do remember, and I don't know how this came to me, but I do remember there was also this idea that Kitty put out there that that when an opportunity to serve presented itself, if you didn't grab it, she would. So it was that, it was putting the emphasis on service in Baba's love. It was a way of, you know, bringing you into that reality of keeping your eye open for opportunities. And she would, if you didn't get it, she would. So that was always kind of cool for me to remember as well about Miss Kitty Davy. Well, there are other people I see here that might have something to share. I know Rosalie was here, but I don't see her. Oh, she might be off camera now. But if there's anybody else, I see Betty and Marcia. I'm not sure if you met Baba. I mean, I know you met Baba in your heart, but I mean, if you have met Kitty.
I didn't meet Kitty.
Yeah.
No.
That's why you're here, I guess. Huh?
Yeah. Well, I read her book and I, you know, I know about her. And when I went to Myrtle Beach, I was invited to a tea, but Kitty Davy wasn't there.
I hear you. Yeah, her book was very important to me. Mm. Very important to me.
Jane is bound to have stories. She's.
Well, this is a different Dana. This is
oh,
Dana.
It is.
Yeah,
oh.
It's Dana Reed.
I see.
Yeah. Oh, Dana. Yeah, Dana would have a lot of stories as well. And Betty, what about yourself, darling?
You know, we met her. We went as a family the year she turned 99. We were there for her 99th birthday, and I remember Jim and others did a great. What's the word? They put on a show, a musical show for her. But so it's, and we had an interview with her, but it was really not, well, I remember we had heard that she liked geckos or lizards or somehow, or was it alligators? Maybe. Anyway, our daughter Shireen found some earrings for her that were, gosh, now I'm not remembering. Lizard, alligator. So we brought her, we brought the earrings, and Shireen was excited to give them to her. But Kitty opened them, and she said, but I'm not pierced. But she said, but somebody will fix it. And she handed it off to, she didn't want to hurt Shireen's feeling. She said, we'll fix it. That was the little memory of Kitty that we had from, yeah.
This, I should say, Kitty had the most amazing ears.
That's true.
I would always couldn't look at Kitty without thinking of the Buddha.
The Buddha, right.
Because Kitty's ears are so phenomenal. I mean, and I don't know about piercings, but she wore very elaborate ear ornaments. If you can see, let me see if I can get the glare off of this. No, that's not that good a picture. Look at the size of her ear ornament. Is that, why aren't we having any luck with some clarity on that picture?
It is. Ralph, did you take many photos of her?
Do you know who took this was a guy from Chicago? And he gave it to Kathy Haas, who years and years later mailed it to me after I'd come out here to Texas. Yeah. Well,
hard to tell what's going
it's
on.
It's a little fuzzy. Yeah, we'll give up on it.
But she did have her earlobes were yes.
Huge earlobes.
Beautiful ears. Yeah. Beautiful and long. You
like
know.
The Buddha. Like the Buddha.
Yeah, long, very long ears. Which do you think? That Kitty really did listen with the ears of Buddha. Yeah. Well.
Yeah, I was always impressed by her earlobes as well. And I know Wendy has a set of earrings that Kitty wore. So I think one of the talks that Wendy gave recently, there were those earrings, and it's just so reminiscent.
Well, and of course, Baba has the Buddha's ears.
Earlobe, yes.
He didn't leave them behind.
Well, I always
brought him with them.
Yes. I always heard that big earlobes meant that you were selfless.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
Well, that was certainly true of Kitty.
Wow. True?
Absolutely, yeah.
He certainly personified that. Yeah, I was going to catch Jim before he left. It seemed that there were a number of years in a row, anybody in Myrtle Beach might remember, where Jim and Marshall would get together and have some kind of a performance for Kitty's birthday. And they were always, if I was lucky enough to be there, they were always memorable. I remember one that they did with, it seemed to me they had top hats and canes.
Yes, that's what I remember.
Yes.
For the 99th, yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So they swept across the stage singing and dancing for Kitty Davy. And, you know, they were her guys. Kitty, you know, just had a great relationship with Marshall and Jim, and they always rose to that beautiful love occasion. Karen Talbot, what have you got for us, darling?
Well, before you end, I have a few mementos of Kitty. And I took our three children and was there for her 100th birthday. And Jim had a wonderful song about how she was 100 today, but looks better than you and I, which is probably very true. But anyway, this is happy 100th birthday, Meher Baba's Kitty. And Baba's holding a little kitten, aged to perfection.
Oh,
you can see that.
Beautiful. Oh, can you show us again, Karen?
Yeah.
Oh, look at that. Oh, that's Woden.
And then there's two, there. This is the invitation, the great big 100th birthday celebration for Kitty. May her spiritual center, August 23rd, 24th, 25th, 1991. And it's a beautiful picture of Baba and Kitty in Venice. I have had another one that was of Baba and Margaret, similar. This is Baba and Kitty. And then Mani wrote a song, Kitty's 100th birthday. The folks are all coming to Myrtle Beach town with the Lord of the universe wearing his crown and his queen so resplendent in silver gown, while angels with garlands are hurrying down for Kitty's 100th birthday. And the chorus, hooray, 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 rah, hooray, 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 hooray. It's Kitty's 100th birthday. Hurrah, hurrah, hooray, hooray, avatar meher baba ki jay. While the guards are a-dancing and cherubs sing, oh, look at the gifts they bring. God's choices, blessings of love so true, in shape of joy and suffering too, for his fortunate slave's birthday. The final chorus, patience and harmony without end are gifts she received from Baba, her friend. She gave up her world when she heard his call, and she became his gift to one and all. Happy, happy birthday. And I guess I was there, we were all there with the kids for the Saturday, August 24th meeting place program. They obviously had two performances. The first was 7:30 p.m. sharp. The second was 9 p.m. sharp because so many people came for that. So many people. The introduction was by Marshall. The video was birthday greetings from the Mondali. Original play with music, A Tale of the New Life by Ward Parks, and cast of 16. Music, Ward Parks, Buzz Connor, Kathy Riley. And here's the end of it, of this.
Okay. You show us the front and the back for higher, please. Ah, there, we can see it, almost, not quite.
I'd have to do it, it's not big enough. And then here's the other side.
Ah.
And then I have something that epitomizes Kitty. Be cheerful in thought, word, deed, and appearance, most of all in appearance. It is a divine art to always look cheerful. It helps others. From one of the calendars that I took out. Saroja.
Oh.
And this is the program of her memorial service. Here's a picture. I almost think it's from the 100th birthday, but it's Jane Haynes, Wendy Haynes, and Kitty.
Oh, sweet. Can you hold it up a bit, Karen?
Yeah.
Oh, beautiful.
And Kitty signed her name. I'm sure it's 100, but there in red is Kitty. And then in memory of Kitty Davy, Meher Baba's beloved Saroja. And this is from Meher Baba. Your love for me, which is your life, speaks my message to all who come to my center and makes me happy. Meher Baba. And I think that's what I have. That's it.
Beautiful.
Say Baba.
Hey, Baba. Thank you. Yes, I have a sweater of Kitty's.
Oh.
I know. I should go grab it, but I'm in the time. Dana? Jay Baba.
Can you see me?
No, I don't see you. Let me see.
Wait. Okay. Good morning, everyone. I just want to say that I never had the privilege of meeting Kitty in person, but through all of you and Ruth, who's my best friend, as you all know, I felt like I did meet Kitty. And I want to know what the secret is that all the Baba women, or so many of them, live to be 100. I kind of think that Baba Bubba wanted them around for as long as possible. When I first met Wendy, Wendy told me, oh, you're all dressed up and you have all your makeup on. And they said, you know what? Kitty and Bubba would have liked that. And I thought, well, that's great. I will always be dressed up and try to look good. But anyway, I thank you all for sharing all of your knowledge with me about Kitty. I always thought she was very, very striking. I thought she was beautiful when she was young, and she just continued to get more beautiful as the years passed. So this is her birthday, and happy birthday, Kitty, and thank you all for sharing with me. Jay Baba.
Baba, Dana. Jay Baba, we love you. Thanks for sharing with us today. And, oh, Betty, I just muted you. I'm sorry, honey.
The picture of Kitty and Baba outside of St. Mark's reminded me. I was so taken. This is it's a bit of a digression. It's about St. Mark's and what Baba said. It's a paragraph from Lord May here.
Please.
They visited St. Mark's Square at 11:30 a.m. And at the suggestion of the gopis, it was decided to enter the church. Outside, Baba explained the church's architecture and its spiritual significance. He had them count and write down the number of pillars, domes, and arches, which came to exactly 120. Baba indicated, this church is one of the four great spiritual centers of Europe. The whole structure corresponds to the Avatar's 12 disciples of the inner circle and 108 disciples of the outer circles. Baba then revealed, I was here as Jesus with two of my apostles 1 month before my crucifixion and sat on the exact spot where St. Mark's was later built. So it was.
Now I was looking at that photo of Kitty and Baba in St. Mark's Square, and just unbelievable. I don't know. I was just seeing how Baba had his arm over her shoulder, and I mean, I would have just been like, you would have seen me as like melted somehow if he had done that, put his arm around me like that. But she's, you know, she just is, I don't know, she just held that presence.
Yeah. Well, it seemed that there were several poses here again in the book. I don't know. He had the one of Kitty, of course, and Margaret. And I think let's see. Here we go.
Spotlight.
It's as if, he said he was there with the gopis, as if they took turns one by one, you know, going and posing with him. I think one of them is Minta. I'm sorry, I'm not reading that. But
oh, beautiful, buddy.
Yeah, photo op. Yeah.
Yeah. How fortunate. How fortunate they were. And as everybody has said, how fortunate we were to receive that from, you know, just to be around to get that opportunity to spend time with them. The other thing that was so cool, and I don't know, Rosalie, did you have anything to add today? Right, you're muted, dear.
There's Mary.
I know.
I need a water. I first came to Meher Center in November of 1971. Kitty was away. So who I met with, Elizabeth. I never had a closeness of any sort with Kitty, but it's as with, I always appreciated every one of the mandali that I was meeting, whatever the meeting was like. It was a precious thing, whether it sometimes is abrasive, you know, it's not always seeing this glowing presence. And I remember one time I was in the book room with Kitty, and I found a
an invitation to one of Narina's talks. And I said, oh, Kitty, look what I found. She shredded it so fast. She went, ch-ch-ch-ch. She says, oh, that was in the past. Well, you know, it's like, I was kind of taken aback. I will say that I am seeing a life that is for service. When I went to India the second time, I ran into Mother Teresa, who happens to have the birthday the day before Kitty's, the 27th. And I went up to her, and she was quite short, but boy, did her face remind me of Kitty. It was quite weathered, but there was a joyousness in the face. And I said, oh, Mother Teresa, I've been wanting to meet you. And she didn't say anything but radiance. And why I think of her and the connection with Kitty, because Kitty was so about service, serving Baba with her life. And in the movie, Mayor Baba's Call, the one that Darwin, and now he's the narrator, Kitty Davy reads How to Love God. And I just knew she's the perfect person to be reading that, How to Love God. And just her voice and just her life, it was perfect. You know, to get a feeling, I have to say, of Kitty, one of the things is, listen to that film, how, you know, it's light, it's kind of matter of fact, this is how you love God. And I will say, when she was in decline, I was in California, so I didn't have much contact with her at all, but Adele Walken, in fact, Kitty was in the hospital, and Adele Walken wanted me to make a card for her, like a communal card. And I really thought it was Baba's hand, because I happened to have this beautiful picture in a book I had of a lotus. And that was Kitty's, Baba's name for Kitty, Sarosha's lotus. So I was able, and also it really kind of turned my head, kind of turn when you have your head turned inward, that, oh yeah, we're all one. We all have our things with each other. And it's important. It's important because Baba does it all. And, you know, the time and the amount of mandali I've met, I'm so grateful. Because of the purity that Baba brought them to, these pure lives, whatever the life was, purified it. And I can't think of people very different than Kitty when Baba surprises her. You're going to stay here at the center and help Elizabeth. She's not happy about it, you know. And but she said yes. And then Baba made a gesture, keep cheerful. And, you know, because Kitty and Elizabeth, very, very different personalities, you know, just all of a sudden, this is how it's going to be. Anyway, it's good to hear about them. You know, each one of them is precious because Baba does, as with each one of us, he does a special work through our being, because we have to be what we are, you know, and it's Baba being in us, you know, that's so precious. you know. Anyway, I'm thankful for Kitty, and I love hearing everyone else's, what they share about this pure soul, really, pure soul. Jay Baba.
Hey, Baba, thank you for bringing up that purity aspect, Rosalie. That was beautiful.
I am.
Ralph, do you want to?
I wanted to say, I don't know if this is recorded, but hard to imagine that it is not. It's probably in Kitty's book, but which I think I've read, it's been a while. I don't know if I read all of it, but Kitty used to occasionally recount, maybe at least twice in the my years of acquaintance with her, that of the instance of Baba making the decision to leave Kitty in Myrtle Beach with Elizabeth. And the way she, the story as Kitty presented it to me was that Baba, it was coming time for Baba to leave. And he said to Kitty, you know, someone needs to stay here and help Elizabeth, because Norina, you know, was near death, I think, with the heart condition. And now this part I'm trying to remember. Either Baba said, and I'm trying to decide, this would be either Rano or you, or else, and Baba said, he might have presented that situation of either or, but he did say for sure, because I'm trying to rely on my memory here, he did say for sure, he says, who do you think it should be? He posed that question to Kitty, who should I leave here? And I think he presented that the choice was either Kitty herself or Rano. And Rano said, Baba, Rano being American, and I would think she would be the natural choice. And he said, no, he didn't hesitate. He said, no, it's you. And I don't remember any words she said after that. That she may not have said anything, but I, like Rosalie, got the feeling that I just can't speak. That'd be tough. That would, I mean, she loved being with Baba so much. But I mean, so it was a big change for her. Then another time, once in a while, I'd get those little stories. When I, real early, when I knew Kitty, somehow we ended up in her library, Baba's library, Saroja Library. And she was showing me, giving me a tour of the library. And she said, she went over by this picture that was, you know, Baba, when he looked like Jesus. And it had a caption below, said, I was Rama, I was Krishna, I was this one, I was that one. And she said, there was an occasion when Baba all of a sudden said to me, and it was before Baba said he would, maybe, I don't know when Baba told them he was Christ, but maybe right away. I think they always felt that he must be, whether he said it or not. And he said, Kitty turned, she's looking at the picture. It was the funniest feeling. We were standing apart. It was like I was seeing her down in a tunnel and the room. And I was aware of the room and what it was, the library, that I was looking at Kitty. And she said, Baba told me, he said, and it was just the two of them, said, I was Rama, I was Krishna, I was Buddha and Jesus, and now I am that one, come again. And said, Baba said that to me. And now how he did it, if she understood his board or gestures, or if someone were there, would have been, in that case, Chanji, I presume, or someone to interpret, or else he managed to convey it to her. And I thought that was, she felt that that was significant, that Baba had shared that with her personally, to two of them. And afterwards, years later, even now, I feel honored that she shared it with me.
Thank you, Ralph.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Well, I think we can wrap up about now, but I just wanted to also bring up one thing. In the early days, we always loved to hear the kiddie-isms. And I didn't know what they were, but somebody introduced me to them, and they said, you know, they were walking by one day, and Kitty's on the phone talking because they'd answer at Dilruba, and people would make arrangements to come to the center. And she said, oh, yes, and don't forget to wear covered shoes so you can walk on the snakes. And then she hung up. So there were always, you know, people would say just these amazing, it just such humor and love sprung out of these kiddie-isms. And there were so many. I just wish that we had recorded some. I was fortunate enough when Kitty dropped the body to be at the center, and we all met in the meeting place, and people got up and spoke and told these kiddie-isms that they had experienced. And they were just always so hilarious. I felt the connection to the center and to Baba because of Kitty Davy. And that's all I can say. I'm just grateful for the opportunity to have met her.
Matthew Riley's book, Dilruba Days, is full of kiddie-isms.
Yes.
She recorded it every day. It was wonderful.
Yes, it is. It's a great book.
Right. What about, does anyone remember when Kitty got so mad at Baba that she threw an orange at him? It didn't hit him. She threw it. I mean, that always struck me because I do remember it clearly. It was an orange and she threw it kind of like near his foot but didn't hit. But I thought, because she's not someone that I think of it with a temper, but you know, for everyone, you know, it's like if Baba brings it up, you know. So no one else remembers that?
It must be.
Yeah, I remember it.
Yeah.
There was a story about her. She was in charge of like the household in India.
She was the head cook. They cooked for a lot of people. There were a lot of people.
Yeah, I don't think she cooked.
And Baba was challenging her, and finally got to her. Finally, he just showed up at the kitchen, and she sensed he was there. She told me it was an apple, and she she couldn't take it that he was back to nag her, and she grabbed the apple and turned around and threw the apple at Baba.
Well, I'm thinking of another story where it was about toast. Baba.
Oh, toast! Yeah.
Told the women they could only have bread and maybe tea in the morning, and then he went away, and then so she. That she was in charge. She was the one who would provide that, and then the women started complaining that the bread was not good on her stomach and toasted. So then she relented with that woman. I bet you know this story, Karen. She and then then that woman had the toast, and then I think there were others. So since she had it, the others had, and then it might have even gotten to jam. I can't remember that by the time. So he took the duty away from her.
Yeah, he took her to task.
Baba called her on it. For me, the important thing, he called her on it. Says, do you want to please me or to please everyone else?
Yes.
That's important, you know, to me. I went, because she likes to please people. Wow.
And she was at quite a loss without that duty. It was a real, you know, it was not some simple thing. It meant she didn't have anything to do for that time. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to close today with just the message from Meherabad, I believe it was, from India. We salute our most precious Kitty Saroja, the oldest disciple of the Ancient One. Her lotus pure reflection of beloved Baba's love will continue to shine at his home in the West and in the hearts and lives of his many lovers who are enriched by the example of her life for her beloved Lord and Master, Avatar Meherbaba. And that is from Meherabad family, Mani and the family when Kitty passed away. So why don't we have a moment of silence, and thank you everyone. Jai Baba. Avatar Meherbaba Ki Jai. Avatar Meherbaba Ki Jai. Avatar Meherbaba Ki Jai. I've got to run, but if anyone would like to stick around, I can make you host.
You can make me host for a bit.
Right. You make me toast.